you know, not that it matters, but it was, you know, things, I wouldn't say Dave quit the band, it just stopped being a productive and fun and creative experience for everybody. It was just kind of, it ended naturally, like, you know, this is not really what it's supposed to be, so let's try moving on.
But you were supposed to be very productive for 1 odd minute.
We were? We were supposed to be?
He was.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, he's a great guy and a great guitar player, and that just kind of ran its course and didn't feel like what we were looking for. And then, you know, suddenly out of the blue, Flea suggested that maybe we could play with John again, which was a terribly exciting prospect, which was the furthest thing from my mind. I didn't think that was really a potential reality, and then it turned out to be, so it was a lucky day.
Mm-hmm. And John, what was your first reaction? What was the first to ask you to come back?
Flea mm-hmm. Came over to my house, and we listened to some music. I was playing him some records, and then he said something I wanted to talk to you about. How do you feel about being Red Hot Chili Peppers again? And I said, yeah, that sounds like it could be good. And we just started talking about it, and we just seemed excited about it. You know, a lot of things had changed since the time that I quit, and we've joined together now in a way of we have a unity and a closeness that we'd gotten really far away from before.
Can you define, can you explain what is different now in To The Papers?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Me and Anthony were friends now. We weren't friends back then.
One difference?
Mm-hmm. It's one difference.
And it's a big difference. It's very important as a difference.
Yeah, it's very important for a band to be friends with each other and to talk to each other and to enjoy each other's company, because you've got to be around these guys all the time, you know. So if somebody's, you know, somebody's way of life or way of thinking isn't gelling with yours, it's a struggle and a pain to go on tour and to make music, you know, just doesn't happen. Whereas when you love each other, you write songs, you're proud of each other, you know, you enjoy each other's performance on stage. We weren't even looking at each other on stage before. I saw a videotape of us back then recently.
From what show?
Troy, New York. And we paid no attention to each other. Nobody in the band paid any attention to each other, because it got to the point where Flea was so mad at me and Anthony for not trying, at least from to me it seemed like just me, maybe you got a vibe from him too. He was mad that we weren't trying to make it work, our relationship, that we weren't trying for the sake of the band to be friends. We just were like content to go around like hating each other. And so Flea started being so mad at me for that mine and Flea's relationship was going downhill too. Now we're all happy to be around each other, be around, you know, and that makes for making good music, you know. At the time that he asked me to join, the idea of getting together every day and making music with people who I love, who share a similar vision of what the purpose of music is, was sounding like the greatest.
Don't you think that sometimes it's safer to be in a band just on a professional level and not personal level?
I'm not worried about that, and I wasn't worried about it when I quit.
And it's never been like that for this band. Mm-hmm. It didn't start like that, and it never really got to that point. And I don't think anybody was ever looking for a safety net to be in this band. Mm-hmm. I mean, I don't think it would be very good if that's the arrangement. You know, if we just got together for making music, it just wouldn't be the way it is.
Yeah, I don't need that kind of safety. You know, it's not the way I approach everything. You know.
But one of the reasons for your departure was the pressure upon the band. Was it not true?
No, just
did it
more,
fade away? Or?
No, the pressure on the band?
Yeah.
No, I didn't quit the band because of the pressure on the band. I think at the time, since I quit, and then me and Flea, or me and Anthony, we never really discussed the reasons why, they would just ask me why, and I just said, I have to, you know. It's just a feeling. Now I understand why I did it, like, and, but like, so they used, they probably said that, like, pressures of being successful, John couldn't handle it.
Who said that?
Flea, I've heard him say things to that effect, you know. but that's not the case. It had nothing to do with the pressures, you know. There's no, nobody was putting any pressures on me because I wasn't doing any interviews at that time. Only pressures were going on tour and playing music, and I loved playing music every night. But the going on tour part of it is no fun if the people you're on tour with aren't your friends, you know. It starts to just be a drag, you know. So yeah, I mean, it's not, I don't really consider them pressures, you know. I didn't like doing the whole thing that you do, being in a band without, you know.
And Anthony, being did you proud take of it. Departure as a betrayal? Was it painful?
It was definitely painful, and I didn't understand what was happening. Mm-hmm. You know, I wasn't really sensitive enough to the situation to know what he was feeling or why he was doing the things he was doing. You know, my vision was a bit narrow at the time, and I just wanted to keep playing. I really liked the record that we made. I was probably missing something that we had from the past when we used to go play live shows together and have a great communication on stage. And I wanted that again, you know, very desperately, you know, because it was just something I was missing. And, you know, I definitely resented him for a while when he quit, but it wasn't coming from a focused place of understanding. It was just kind of a free-floating resentment, like, you know, this just sucks, and, you know, why does he have to go do that? But much more powerful to me at the time was just a real sense of loss. And I knew that somewhere in there that I had done something that was, you know, that was selfish enough to where it didn't work. And, you know, I just missed him, and I was pissed off at him, and, you know, I cared about him. And really, you know, that was a lot of stuff that happened, and I guess you're curious about it because it was a big explosion at the time. But, you know, never in my wildest dreams did I think that we'd come together again to play music. No, I never considered it. You know, my main thing was just that I wanted John to know that I did love him, and that I didn't want either of us to die without, you know, reestablishing a connection. And that was my biggest fear, is that, you know, either I'd get a call one day saying John is dead, and I would have never been able to tell him that even though shit got fucked up, I still love you and I still care about you and I think about you. So, you know, just the first day that we started playing together, I felt, you know, a huge blessing. And then it just got more and more fun. And
you didn't have in mind to reform a winning team?
A winning team? Yeah, we had it in mind to reform a winning team. Uh-huh. But, you know, that's a sort of an intellectual prospect that is easier said than done. You know, we definitely wanted to carry on, and we tried many times. You know, we played with so many different people after he left, and never found a beautiful chemistry. You know, we never found a chemistry where we were happy and where we were creative, and where we all understood each other and had a desire every day to play with each other. You know, it became more of just something to do because we were supposed to do it. And that changed, you know, the minute we got together like this again. It just became, we're doing it because we love it. Mm. Yeah, we tried to get a winning team. You know, there's not a lot of first round draft choices out there.
For instance, was it obvious to you to use again Rick Rubin as a producer?
Was it obvious?
Yeah.
For One Hot Minute? Or for this record?
For this record.
It was not obvious. It was not obvious. We became so in love with the experience of playing music and writing songs over the summer. We were very committed to it, and suddenly we realized that we were onto something very special, and that the songs we were writing were as good as any songs we had ever written. And we wanted a producer who had the same kind of all or nothing enthusiasm for the record we were about to make, because that's all we cared about, and that's all we were focused on. And at first, we maybe had doubts.
We were devoting our whole lives to the record, and Rick seemed like he likes doing a bunch of things at once, you know. He normally produces a couple of albums at one time, plus runs his record company, and we felt that he might be too distracted, you know, that he couldn't give himself to us 100%.
Right. So, crossed our mind, but in the end, it was the greatest thing to work with him, because he fell in love with the music just like we did, and probably worked harder and longer and more from the heart than any of the other times we ever worked with him, you know. He's right now, as we're sitting here, he's in New York, you know, doing extra work to make sure that everything is perfect for the mastering of our record, which is not like Rick to do something like that.
Seven Up presents.
Blood Sugar Sex and Magic was a massive hit, but do you consider the album as a masterpiece? Or is it just a step in your musical evolution?
I just think of it as the songs that we wrote during a really great year, you know, during like probably the happiest time of my life that I've ever had. You know, they're the songs that we wrote during that time period, and we recorded them, you know, in the period ended. Like, I don't see the final thing as being a masterpiece, but I see it as, you know, really great album.
There are probably a couple of songs on that record that could have stayed home and not made it on the record.
But what about a song like Under the Bridge? Was it, in a way, a curse or a blessing to write a song?
I think that song is probably close to being a masterpiece, considering it's only like 2.5 minutes and it's really like...
Is it?
Yeah, it's real short.
I had no idea.
Extremely
I had no
short.
Idea.
Yeah, real short song, and it's really powerful, you know? And it's like, I'm very happy we wrote that song. I mean, that song is a very sad song, you know? When Anthony first came in with the idea for the vocals and the lyrics, we were just like, oh, Jesus,
what yeah.
depressing.
It was funny, because I wasn't going to take it in. I definitely wasn't going to take it in to the band practice. And then and Rick looked at it in my notes, and he's like, well, hello, what about this? And I was like, please, let's move on. And he said, no, I think you should go in there and sing that. And the day I went to sing it was just Chad and John. Flea was late or didn't come that day or something. And I was just so prepared for them to kind of go, okay, thanks for sharing, but you know, we got other things to move on to, and they got sad. But it was not a curse. It wasn't a curse. Just because you have a popular song that, you know, people associate your band with, it doesn't matter in the end.
But in a way, you were ashamed to express those feelings of loneliness and sadness?
I was not, it wasn't shame.
Yeah, not ashamed, just shy because, shy. You know, because why?
Why was I shy? Because I'm a shy guy.
Yeah, I mean, it's just, you know, you express things a certain way with your words, and up to that point, you know, you'd been like used to more expressing like good celebrating kind of feelings, celebration of life kind of feelings, and writing lyrics that were just totally, you know, about how lonely he was and sad and feeling without a friend. Was just a real deep kind of part of himself to bust out with, you know. But he did it, and we made it into a really good song.
You did a lot of covers on stage or on record. What were your reaction when All Saints cover Under the Bridge?
A reaction?
Yeah. Were you proud or uncomfortable? Or?
Maybe I would have regretted writing it if I heard it. I don't know. I've never heard it.
What, the All Saints version?
No, I've never heard it.
Right. I was more amused than anything else. You know, I didn't, you know, swell up with pride, or it didn't make me angry. I just thought.
I read in Rolling Stone magazine that you were at Big Sur all together to just to practice and making music. And for one odd minute, I guess, if I can remember, you were in Hawaii all together, the band, I mean. You need from time to time to gather all the band and just play music for the pleasure of it?
Yeah, those were two different experiences, though. You know, when we went to Hawaii, it's because we were looking to establish some, you know, communication and experience together. It was just different. You know, when we went to Big Sur, it was just Flea and John and myself, and it was purely for fun, and we had one small mission, which was to write an acoustic song, one single song with acoustic instruments, and to go surfing and to, you know, have some good food and listen to music on the way up. And Flea had just gotten a new truck, so we were breaking it in. That was purely a road trip, you know, just for the sake of fun. And you know, it was,
yeah, we were there for a few days, and we just only, you know, a few hours, like 3 or 4 hours were probably spent writing that song, you know, bulk of it just being Anthony writing lyrics while me and Flea were taking naps.
Usually into the credits, the whole band sign the songs. But how do you work actually?
The whole band sang the
songs.
Sign the songs. Yeah.
How do you work actually? Is it always a song came always from a jam between the all of us, of you?
Well, it's always never anything. Everything.
It's always different. Sometimes I start a song by with an idea on the guitar, and Flea writes a bass line, and Chad writes a drum part, and then we all just talk about what other kind of section the song needs, and then that comes along, and then Anthony starts singing something that makes us think of something else, and you know, or a song could come from Chad just playing a drum beat and us playing along with him, and you know, they come all different ways, all different combinations.
Yeah, there's no set way, there's no formula, and there's no boundaries. It can go wherever it wants to go. And in the end, the way we figure is that we all eventually put into it, so.
Like, we thought that the song Road Trip and needed drums. Chad's input and the reason he gets the writing credit on that song is because he said no drums. He said it doesn't need any drums, and we figured that's worth the credit for songwriting.
That's a good point. That's a good point.
A sign of your genius.
I wish you'd have that idea more often. Just kidding.
Can you summarize the album, the mood of the global mood of the brand new album with few words?
Can we summarize the record in a few words?
Yeah. Is it about lost, the feeling of lost, or
lost?
Yeah.
L-U-S-T?
No, loss. L-O-S-S.
Oh, loss. Oh, that's a Lou Reed record, Magic and Loss.
Uh-huh.
You familiar with that one?
Yeah.
I'm not really big on summarizing. Yeah. We had so much fun making it. It felt so good to be back together and to be going in a direction that it would have only happened with getting together every day like that. You know, we couldn't imagine what we were going to come up with, and it just felt so good to come up with these songs. And I think it's as good of a record as we ever made. It's based on everything, not just loss. It's more based on the opposite of loss, you know, re-blossoming of sorts.
Right.
Yeah.
Because you talk over and over about the pleasure you had making the album, but the album seems to me very sensitive and in a way a bit serious and hurtful in a way.
Yeah, well, there's pleasure to be had with those things.
Yeah, I mean, a lot of the time some of the music that gives me the most, that makes me feel the happiest, is music that's that people say is sad or depressing or something. But with music you can recreate all kinds of feelings that exist in the universe, you know, and I think on our new album has a wide spectrum of them, you know. It's not any one kinds of songs. I like the way that we've gone, that we've gone about letting the feelings come through us and expressing them with our instruments in a way that sounds really modern, but at the same time takes roots from the kind of originality and colorful playing that people did during the periods of new wave and punk rock, but at the same time it sounds modern and without having any electronics, and still each section has its own texture and feeling to it. I'm real proud of all that.
The song Californication, I read those lines. Destruction leads to a very rough road, but it also breeds creation. Does it apply to you? To the papers, I mean?
To the papers?
Yeah.
Yeah, it applies to us, for sure. Mm-hmm. For sure. I think it applies to everything in the universe, but specifically that, to me, was descriptive of my personal life and of my life in this band, and just all of those things that didn't end up destroying us, you know, led to this. So, and this was very creative time in all of our lives.
But do you think it's very necessary?
Do I think it's very necessary?
Yeah. Don't you want to change it?
Change what?
Change
the way you need difficulties.
Well, I didn't try to create it in the first place. It just happened.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, there's certain things in fate you have no control over, you know? Fate, like, is the way it is. You can only force yourself upon your fate in simple ways, like what you eat and how much you smoke and what you say to your friends and what you say to the people you pass by in the street. But all the rest of it, it's just stuff that happens to you, you know? The songs you write, it's not your decision, you know, whether or not you go through hard times, whether or not somebody dies who's a friend of yours, whether or not you start destroying yourself, like, these are things you don't have all say in, you know?
But you need 4 years to make a brand new album. Is it novel or is it?
We didn't need 4 years. I mean, once we got together, it was a year ago today or something like that we got together, so. And when we talk to you in a year from now, we'll have a new record.
Yeah, this record didn't take us 4 years to make. It took us about 9 months. And the recording of it itself took only about 3 weeks. That's very quick, you know.
Yeah.
In the future, we're going to try to put out a record every day. So. Wow.
I can wait for that. I read an interview of Flea where he said that he's very uncomfortable with rich people. because when he grew up, he ate rich people. What about you? Are you more comfortable than he is?
That's a funny thing to say. Yeah. Makes no difference to me.
Yeah.
Makes no difference to me.
I would say I'm less comfortable around rich people than I am around poor people, but I don't know. I mean, you know, I'm the same way as Flea. I didn't have money when I was a little kid. We were on welfare and stuff. That means that's like where you get money from the government because you can't get a job when you're a kid and stuff. Yeah.
Have you ever fallen in love with a rich girl?
No.
No. Have you ever fallen in love with a rich girl?
No.
Me either.
It's a shame. What about you?
No, I fell in love with a girl who was dirt poor. You know, week to week style. Mm-hmm. But, you know, I'm friends with Flea, and Flea's pretty rich, so I guess I'm comfortable with that.